It is now time for question period. The member from Renfrew-Nipissing.
Thank you very much, Speaker. My question is to the Minister of Energy. Minister, escalating hydro rates are having a devastating effect on people here in Ontario. People in from my riding of Renfrew-Nipissing, Pembroke, and all across Ontario are struggling because of the mess you've made of the energy system. Skyrocketing rates are having a devastating effect on people, real people. They're having to make hard choices. They're having to choose whether to heat or eat. This is because under your disastrous Green Energy Act, you continue to sign contracts for expensive, intermittent, unreliable power. This is forcing hundreds of thousands of families into untenable circumstances. Minister, how many more hundreds of thousands will be energy poor if you continue down your disastrous path?
Thank you. Excellent. Minister of Energy.
Mr. Speaker, I welcome the question, and certainly hydro rates are a very topical issue. We understand that the investments we made to take a dirty and unreliable system, Mr. Speaker, and make it clean and reliable are putting pressures on Ontario families, particularly electric heat in rural areas, Mr. Speaker. To help families with their energy bills, we announced further price mitigation measures in our budget, Mr. Speaker, which neither of the opposition parties supported, incidentally, removing the debt retirement charge by the end of this year, 2 years earlier than planned, saving the average family $70 per year in their hydro bills, Mr. Speaker. And the Ontario Energy Board is implementing the Ontario Electricity Support Program for low and modest income families that will save them an average of $360 per year off their bills, or $430 when combined with the removal of the DRC. Mr. Speaker, we have a number of other programs which I'll talk to in the supplementary. Thank you.
Thank you. Supplementary.
Back to the minister. People have had enough with your government's unaffordable hydro rates. They have come here today from all across Ontario to express their frustration and to let you know that they are fed up. They're here today to tell you that they cannot afford energy at 16.1 cents a kilowatt hour, or what you have dismissively called a cup of coffee. You're forcing them to choose between heating their homes or putting food on the table. These victims of your reckless energy policies desperately need you to finally show some understanding and compassion.
Minister of Tourism.
Minister, will you go out after question period today and face the people that you have caused so much harm to, or will you just continue to ignore them?
Minister. Be seated, please. Be seated, please. Thank you. Excuse me. Stop the clock. I'm now going to implement what I have done last week and this week. The person that starts to talk while I'm standing is going to be named. Carry on.
Mr. Speaker, I have indicated to my staff that they can make arrangements with representatives of the group that will be here today, that I would be happy to meet with them in one of the rooms here at Queen's Park or in my office across the way. Mr. Speaker, we have had tremendous pressure because we put big investments into the system. Mr. Speaker, I have a quote here from the member for Simcoe Gray, former Energy Minister Jim Wilson. This is a quote that says, "This summer, when we didn't have enough electricity in this province, when this government was in power, and all of the air conditioners were running, we had to buy power. I had to spend $7 million one day to keep the air conditioners on in our hospitals." Mr. Speaker, that's what the acting leader said when he was Minister of Energy. Since that time, Mr. Speaker, we've invested $34 billion in the system. Not only that, Mr. Speaker, what we did do is we provided significant mitigation measures to counter those significant investments. And
thank you. Final supplementary, the member from Lanark-Fornick-Fornick-Fornick-Addington.
Your government continues to claim that Ontario's electricity rates are amongst the most competitive in North America. The fact is, that's not accurate. I've sent a provincial comparison of hydro rates to every member of this legislature that reveals the true cost of electricity. Ontario, the true cost of your mess that you've made. Ontario is not even remotely competitive. Our all-in hydro cost is the most expensive than any other province in Canada. We pay double what Manitoba pays, we pay triple what Quebec pays. Minister, enough is enough. Will you stop making up your own facts? and finally be honest with the people of Ontario and admit that your failed hydro policy has led to the most expensive hydro in the land?
Thank you. Minister.
Mr. Speaker, I'm going to mention a number of programs which we never hear the members opposite mention. Mr. Speaker, the Ontario Clean Energy Benefit is still in place, Mr. Speaker, which represents a 10% discount off the average consumer's bill. Mr. Speaker, we have the Ontario Energy and Property Tax Credit, which can give a senior up to $1,131 per year off their electricity rate. We have the Low Income Energy Assistance Program in place today, Mr. Speaker, the Save on Energy Home Assistance Program, and for the Northerners, the Northern Ontario Energy Credit. Mr. Speaker, they will send out messages to their constituents with all the rhetoric about high prices. You will never once see them in any of their householders list all the benefits, all the credits, and all the mitigation measures that they can obtain in the system, Mr. Speaker. They don't talk about the good side, they only talk about the bad side.
Thank you. New question. The Leader of Her Majesty's Loyal Opposition.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. My question is for the Premier. Premier, time and time again, we have asked you to take action to fix skyrocketing hydro rates in this province, but you've done nothing. And now, with the removal of the clean energy benefit and the latest 15% increase in time-of-use pricing, Ontarians will have to pay an extra $205 for hydro next year.
Shocking.
People are fed up with your rate increases, and they've come here to tell you face-to-face. Premier, will you join with me and my colleagues after question period on the front lawn and explain to the hundreds of people gathered there, concerned ratepayers, why their hydro rates continue to skyrocket?
Speaker, and I know the Minister of Energy will want to speak to the supplementary, but Mr. Speaker, as the Minister of Energy has said, he is going to be meeting with some of the folks from the group who are outside, because, Mr. Speaker, it's very important that the people who are concerned about this issue get the whole story, that they get the whole story about the mitigations that have been put in place by our government, Mr. Speaker.
Member from Leeds,
Grenville. The reality is that we had to make the investments in the energy system that we have made, Mr. Speaker, in order for it to be reliable. When I ran for office in 2002-2003, Mr. Speaker,
oh, I wish I could find the one that said that. Carry on, please.
Mr. Speaker, when I ran for office in 2002-2003, Mr. Speaker, door after door, people were worried about the reliability of the system. They were worried about whether the lights were going to go on, Mr. Speaker, because of the brownouts and blackouts that were happening across the province. We've dealt with that, Mr. Speaker. We have a reliable system, and we need that in order for our residents and our businesses to be able to thrive, Mr. Speaker.
Supplementary, a member from the P.
Thank you, Speaker. Back to the Premier. Nepean Carleton residents are also paying sky-high hydro bills like elsewhere in the province. They've been subjected to not just infrastructure improvements, but to a disastrous wind energy scam, the smart meter debacle, cancelled gas plants, and a growing, inefficient hydro bureaucracy. They're paying more for their hydro bill today because this government is making a mess out of the hydro system. And all this while some of my residents in Nepean Carleton are serviced by Hydro One, while others are serviced by the less expensive and better managed Ottawa Hydro. Both the Chair of Ottawa Hydro and the Mayor of Ottawa have reached out to the province for a more equitable arrangement for hydro users in rural and suburban Ottawa. Will the Premier commit today to a better electricity arrangement for the rural residents and suburban residents of Ottawa so that they can be serviced by Ottawa Hydro?
Speaker, I'm not going to wade into the details of that discussion. As the member opposite knows, there will be a new board in place at Hydro One, and it will be up to that company, which will be an improved and more efficient company, to deal with those issues. But I want to go to a comment that the member made at the beginning of her question, Mr. Speaker. She talked about her constituents being subjected to infrastructure improvements, Mr. Speaker. That is a very, very telling phrase, because what it says, Mr. Speaker, is that that party and the people across the floor don't believe in improving infrastructure, don't believe in making upgrades to the electricity system, Mr. Speaker.
It's coming from both sides. But the member from Nepean Carleton asked the question. Come to order. Sounds to me like the member is challenging the chair. Would you like to do that?
No, I was just challenging
you. You're now challenging me. Carry on.
The member opposite fundamentally believes that making the kinds of upgrades that were needed in the electricity system, investing in the infrastructure that is needed in this province, is not the way to go, and in fact it subjects the residents of this province, Ontarians, to some kind of hardship. We categorically reject that argument, Mr. Speaker.
Supplementary, the final supplementary.
Oh. Be seated, please. Be seated, please.
Thank you. The member from Bruce Gray Owen Sound, final supplementary.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. To the Minister of Energy. Minister, as you're aware, long-term care operators across Ontario are facing major increases in their hydro bills. Nursing homes do not have sufficient ongoing funding to keep up with your skyrocketing electricity rates. As a result, service levels will decline, and the 100,000 vulnerable seniors housed there will suffer. Minister, will you stand in your place today and give assurance that you will fix your hydro mess and stop forcing seniors' homes to use CARE funding to offset the effect of your skyrocketing electricity rates?
Unbelievable.
Thank you, Premier.
Minister of Energy.
Mr. Speaker, I indicated earlier today a quote from the member from Simcoe Gray, the mess the system was in. We've invested $34 billion into the system, Mr. Speaker. It was a dirty system. It's now a clean system. Yes. It's a healthy system from those investments. The system was not reliable.
Member from Stormont.
There were blackouts and brownouts across the province of Ontario under that administration, Mr. Speaker. We have a system that is clean. We have a system that is reliable as a result of those investments. Yes, it has put pressure on prices. I've listed the mitigation measures.
Second time for the member from Stormont, Dundas and South Glengarry. Carry on.
I've listed the mitigation measures we put in place, and we're continuing to put in place with the new low energy support program, Mr. Speaker, and taking the debt retirement charge off. This government made the mess. They have no positive recommendations whatsoever other than to stand there and yell and scream. Mr. Speaker, that's disgraceful.
Thank you. New question, Leader of the Third Party.
Thank you, Speaker. Everyone knows that this government has never met a panel or a study that it didn't like. In 2013, the Liberal government had over 30 panels and studies. Since January of this year, the government has had 18 more that have been initiated, including one about where to sell Bud Light in the province of Ontario. Now, it appears that last week the Liberals finally changed their ways and they decided to ram the Hydro One sell-off through the legislature without any real public scrutiny or debate at all. Yesterday they rang bells so that the House couldn't debate the fact that the Premier was shutting down democracy in this chamber. Now, can the Premier explain why it is that she's spending months upon months on public consultations, on new systems for how to pay traffic tickets, Speaker, but shutting down
Thank
debate
you.
On Hydro One?
Thank you. Premier.
Government House Leader.
Well, thank you very much, Speaker, and I appreciate the question. I think the member opposite knows quite well the about a debate that is, has taken place on our budget bill, Building Ontario Up. And not to mention, Speaker, the amount...
The member from Timmins, James Bay, will come to order. Carry on.
Thank you, Speaker. Not to mention, Speaker, the amount of public hearings that has taken place before the tabling of the budget. As it has been mentioned before, the Minister of Finance had about six pre-budget consultations held across Ontario. He was in cities and towns like Windsor, London, Toronto, Mississauga, Cambridge, and Ottawa. And the Standing Committee on Finance and Economic Affairs, Speaker, visited towns like Fort Frances, Sudbury, Ottawa, Cornwall, Fort Erie, Toronto, and London to speak to Ontarians and make sure that budget is in.
Thank you. Supplementary.
Not one of those public consultations did this government or did any of those MPPs admit to the people that they were going to be selling off Hydro One. That is a fact. Every single person, Speaker, and every
every single business in this province will pay for the privatizing of Hydro One. Bills have already quadrupled since privatization began in this province, and there's only going to be a faster increase in rates if Liberals go ahead with the privatization of Hydro One. But Ontarians won't get their say at hearing, Speaker, nor will they, their elected representatives be able to get any opportunity, because in less than an hour, from right now, the Liberals are going to pass a closure motion and shut down democratic process in this legislature. My question is, why is this Premier so disrespectful of this legislature, and why has she no intention to listen to the people of Ontario?
Speaker, this government...
Carry on.
Speaker, this government and this Premier is always listening to the people, and consultation after consultation after consultation from the people of Ontario, they are telling us that they want their government to invest in infrastructure, Speaker. They're telling us that they want their government to invest in public transit and transportation infrastructure across the province. They're telling us that we need to invest in our critically important infrastructure like roads and bridges. And what the opposition, Speaker, is doing is they're denying that reality by not wanting to invest in infrastructure, in fact, delaying those very critical investments that are such a key part of our budget, building Ontario up. Speaker, that is what the Premier is doing. She's making unprecedented $130 billion over 10-year investment in our infrastructure so that we continue to build Ontario up and prepare our province for success in the 21st century.
Final supplementary.
Speaker, the Premier has spent months and months consulting and studying how people pay parking tickets in the province of Ontario. She's spending months trying to figure out where to sell a 12-pack of Bud Light. But when there is an issue that affects every single Ontarian, skyrocketing hydro bills, the Premier shuts down democratic debate and refuses to hear from people. It's clear that this Premier will do anything and everything to avoid transparency and to avoid accountability. She is shutting down debate in the legislature. She's ringing bells. She's ramming through her hydro sell-off right through this House. Why is the Premier refusing to hear from Ontarians who can't afford her hydro sell-off?
Speaker, with all due respect, we disagree with the leader of the third party, because we are having very robust debate on this budget bill right in this House, Speaker. Not to mention, Speaker, we have proposed to have 6 days of hearing in the committee, way more than any other opposition parties when they were government ever conducted hearings in the committee. Let me remind the member opposite, when her party was in office, how much time did they give their budget documents to be debated and considered in the committee? In 1991, Speaker, NDP...
Right on the edge. Finish, please.
Speaker, in 1991, NDP allowed for only 1 day of committee consideration on the budget bill. In 1992, only 1 day of budget consideration in the committee.
That's
in 1993 and 1994, Speaker, 0 days.
Zero.
The member from Hamilton East Stoney Creek, come to order. New question. The leader of the third party.
Here, my next question is also for the Premier. The Premier is cutting $500 million out of education. And on top of that, schools are going to have to pay the price for the selling off of hydro. The Liberal Minister of Education was right when she...
Clock. Order. Please finish.
The Minister of Education was right when she said, and I quote, "The privatization of Hydro One will further exacerbate already underfunded school boards and school board budgets." My question is this: what is the Premier going to do? What is she going to cut out of our kids' education next so that school boards can afford to keep the lights on and the schools warm during the winter? Minister of Education?
Minister of Education.
I'm not sure whether to just start with the lesson on fractions, where 248 is approximately, you know, anyway. Could we talk about this whole issue, though, of...
Finish, please.
If you look back at the time, you would find that everybody, including the government of the day's own consultant, agreed that school boards were underfunded by $1 billion. Since I made that statement, we have added $8 billion. Now, another thing you might like to know, Speaker, was that in the original funding formula, the transfer to school boards to pay the utilities had actually been frozen.
Answer.
We have changed that. We now increase the funding every year so that boards can pay for the utilities, and that's no longer.
Thank you. Supplementary.
In Ontario have had 8 years of funding that hasn't even kept up with inflation, and 4 years, Speaker, those budgets have been frozen 4 years in a row. Hospitals are also going to have to grapple with paying the price for the privatization of Hydro One, Speaker. When hydro bills skyrocket, hospitals are going to have to find that money somewhere. What's the Premier going to cut out of hospitals next so that they can keep their lights on and maintain the medical equipment that people rely on to keep their lives safe and well?
Minister of Education.
Speaker, under this government, the school board funding has gone up 56%. The funding per pupil has gone up 59%. Just as a matter of information, teacher wages have gone up 24.5%. The cost of living has gone up 21%. I think she better check her math.
Order. Start the clock. Final supplementary.
All Ontarians need to do is look at the chaos in the school system. Nothing to crow about, Minister. Hydro bills will skyrocket if the Premier privatizes Hydro One, Speaker. It means families and businesses are going to be paying more. But it also means that school boards are going to be paying more. It means that hospitals are going to be paying more. It is going to hurt service agencies. It is going to hurt not-for-profits. If they pay a hydro bill, Speaker, they're going to pay more. Groups who help the most vulnerable and who have to be careful with every dime will be paying the price for this Liberal Premier's sell-off of Hydro One. Will she stop that sell-off today and do right by the people of Ontario?
So let's look at the context in which I was concerned about the privatization, the sell-off of Hydro One. In that context, the Tories were going to sell off 100% in a fire sale all at the same time. That's not what we're doing, Speaker. What we're doing is retaining 40% ownership. We're not selling it all at once in a fire sale. We're doing it in a measured way, no more than 15% at a time, so that we can maximize the value.
One wrap-up sentence, please.
In fact, the context is totally different, and I stand by our school board funding compared to either of the other parties opposite.
Stop the clock, please. The opportunity was missed earlier, and I beg your indulgence for a request for a unanimous consent for the wearing of buttons. So that I will ask for that request now to ensure that we all fall within the guidelines of the House. Member from Halton.
Order. I believe you will find that we have unanimous consent for members to wear buttons in recognition of the Ontario Alzheimer's Society. Thank you.
The member from Halton is seeking unanimous consent to wear the buttons for Alzheimer's. Do we agree?
Agreed.
Agreed. All buttons are made available. All caucuses on each side of the House. We will now resume question period. New question, the member from Simcoe North.
Mr. Speaker, my question is to the Premier. We all know that the three striking school boards have filed a motion with the Labour Relations Board, and we really believe that's a waste of time. The bottom line is that the Liberal government is responsible for the issues and that they will get the students back to the classrooms. The two-tiered Bill 122 is the real problem. The buck stops with Minister Sandals, and it is the Wynn Liberals who are failing Ontario students. Premier, will you finally take responsibility and get...
Sorry for the interruption. The discussions that are going on between other members is not acceptable, and it stops. The member has to put his question properly. Carry on.
Premier, will you finally take responsibility, quit dithering, and get the students back in the classroom?
Premier.
So, Mr. Speaker, the member opposite knows that there is a collective bargaining process that is underway, and it is it's a challenging round of negotiations. There is no doubt about that, Mr. Speaker. We have said that there is no new money for compensation. There are issues that the members need to work out both at the local level and at the central table, Mr. Speaker. The fact is that we need to let that process unfold, because where the deal is going to be found is at the table. I know that the member opposite doesn't support the collective bargaining process. That was evident when they were in office, Mr. Speaker. We believe that it is an important part of labour relations, and so we support that collective bargaining process, and the answers need to be found at the table, Mr. Speaker.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker, and it's back to the Premier. Premier, there were no negotiations yesterday. There's no bargaining talks. Some 22,000 students right now have been out of the classroom on their 16th day.
Wow.
You are supposed to light a fire under the negotiations. We haven't even seen a spark yet. Does she need some kindling? Does she need to borrow some kindling? Maybe we could use that stupid budget you presented. All we see are helpless school boards taking the heat for your mismanagement. The Liberal government must step up, take responsibility, quit dithering, and get the students back in the classroom. Premier, when will you get the 72,000 students in Ontario back in the classroom? Make it happen today.
Thank you. Premier.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. So, again, I will just say to the member opposite, it is not helpful for the collective bargaining process to be held in public. It has to be a process that happens at the table.
Yep.
It has to be a confidential process, Mr. Speaker. What I will say to the member opposite is that the OSSTF support staff are actually negotiating today, Mr. Speaker. They are at the table. So the conversations that are happening in a confidential manner, Mr. Speaker. The agreements have to be found at the table. Look, I want the kids back in school. I want the teachers and the support staff in school. That's where they all want to be, Mr. Speaker, and that is where we want them to be. We are doing everything in our power to make sure that we find those agreements at the table, but it is a difficult process, Mr. Speaker, and I acknowledge that,
yes,
but
sir.
We take responsibility for our role in making that happen, getting those agreements at the table, Mr. Speaker.
New question, the member from Toronto, Danforth.
Thank you, Speaker. Speaker, my question to the Premier. The Premier insists that selling Hydro One is essential, even though it pays for less than 3% of her infrastructure promises. But the truth is, it might pay for a lot less than 3%. Dr. Douglas Peters, chief economist for TD Bank for 26 years, a former federal secretary of state, and his colleague, Dr. David Peters, say, quote, "The Council believes that Hydro One could have a value in the marketplace of $13.5 billion to $15 billion. We think the Council is too optimistic, and $10.6 billion is a more likely valuation." Premier, isn't it true that the net $4 billion you say will come from your fire sale could in fact be a lot lower?
I know the Minister of Energy is going to want to speak to the supplementary, but let me just say this, that the whole reason that we are embarking on this process, the whole reason we ran on reviewing our assets, Mr. Speaker, and using them to leverage the building of new assets for this century, Mr. Speaker, and for our kids and our grandkids, is that that infrastructure needs to be built. What we hear from the third party is basically do nothing. Don't do it. Don't make those investments. Don't build those roads and bridges and transit, Mr. Speaker. Just sit back and pretend that somehow our economy is going to grow, that our communities are going to thrive if we don't make those investments. That is not the case, Mr. Speaker. They will not thrive unless we make those investments. That's what government exists to do, is to put the conditions in place for economic growth and prosperity. That's why we're making those investments.
Thank you. Supplementary.
Speaker, the Premier says she'll get $4 billion for selling Hydro One. And the cost is higher hydro bills for families and businesses. Ontarians losing control of an asset that's too important to give away. And according to senior economists, the truth is that the $4 billion figure is probably inflated, which means that that money isn't going to make the difference to infrastructure that needs to be made. Does the Premier have anything other than a wing and a prayer to back up her claim that selling hydro will give us $4 billion?
Good question.
Minister of Finance.
Mr. Speaker, the member opposite is actually making a lot of speculation, which actually harms the opportunities to create greater value.
Member for Renfrew-Nipissing Pembroke, second time. Carry on.
And that actually precludes us from creating greater value from that corporation. Bottom line is, we are assessing, we are going to foster the conditions necessary to provide the maximum value for a very precious Crown corporation that we all value. And in order for us to ensure that we make it secure, we work in the best interests of the public. And that is what we're doing here, Mr. Speaker, because we're reinvesting dollar for dollar all of that money into another project to generate even more revenue and more returns. And, Mr. Speaker, that's in the best interest of the public, and that is what we're doing. Thank you.
The member from Cambridge.
Thank you, Speaker. My question is for the Minister of Citizenship, Immigration and International Trade. The Cambridge Farmers Market has operated since 1830, supporting our local farmers. My constituents in Cambridge and North Dumfries Township already buy local products, so they were very pleased when the Premier announced her Agri-Food Growth Challenge. The challenge aims to double the agri-food sector's rate of growth and create 120,000 new jobs by 2020. Ontarians working in the agriculture sector, like the many farmers in my riding, are excited about the potential benefits to their businesses. Many agricultural and food companies in my community employ over 50 workers, such as Frito-Lay Canada, Loblaws Company, Dover Flour Mills, and Grand River Foods. Speaker, could the minister tell the House what steps the government's taking to contribute to the Agri-Food Growth Challenge?
Minister of Citizenship, Immigration and International Trade.
Thank you, Speaker, for the opportunity. And I want to thank the honourable member from Cambridge for asking the question. Speaker, outreaching the world is a key driver of our economy. Just last month, I had the pleasure of joining Minister Neal on the first ever minister-led agricultural trade mission to China. Expanding trade is a key part of developing and strengthening Ontario industries. China is a priority market for Ontario and is one of the province's key Asian markets. In 2014, Speaker, Ontario's total agri-food sales to China, including export to Hong Kong, reached over $800 million, representing Ontario's second largest export market for agri-food products. Speaker, trade mission ideas allow us opportunity to showcase Ontario's export. Thank you, Speaker.
Thank you. Supplementary.
Thank you, Speaker, and thank you to the Minister for sharing an update on the Agri-Food Growth Challenge. And I'm glad that the Minister spoke about his recent mission to China. I think we can all agree that by expanding our trade opportunities, it can only mean good things for our economy. In my riding of Cambridge, over 76% of companies in the food and agricultural sector have reported exporting product to other countries. Speaker, Ontario's agri-food sector is, in my opinion, the best in the world. We have some phenomenal products, and they deserve to be showcased worldwide. In particular, trading partners like China need to be able to see what we have to offer. Speaker, could the minister speak more about the recent mission to China and the benefits that all Ontarians will see as a result?
Question. Thank you, Minister.
Thank you, Speaker. Of course, I'm happy to do that. But
Speaker, 20 Ontario business and organizations accompany us to help promote trade opportunities to over 300 Chinese agri-food and government officials. This mission produced some great results for Ontario's agricultural sector. For example, Futuric Global Sourcing signed a letter of intent to purchase 2 million worth of Ontario maple products in the next 2 years. Palatieri Estate signed a 6 million agreement that will bring more Ontario ice wine to China. Wildland Estate Winery announced a retailing and distribution agreement that will see more than 1 million of his product sold in China. As well, Speaker, we have landed free reward trade mission coming to Ontario later this year. Thank you so much.
Question, the member from Prince Edward Hastings.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. My question this morning is for the Minister of Energy. Minister, too many Ontarians are getting to the point now where they're having to choose between heating and eating. For one family in North Hastings who contacted my office, energy poverty is a reality. They've set up payment plans twice with Hydro One, only to end up defaulting both times. Last year, when their child had to have surgery and unexpected expenses arose, they found themselves unable to set up further payment plan arrangements. Their complaints fell on deaf ears with the utility. My office had to work to get them a one-month extension. My office has become an unofficial complaints department for Hydro One. On May 1st, electricity rates just 2 weeks ago went up by another 15%. Minister, why is your Liberal electricity policy such a failure? When you fix it, and will you stop forcing families to choose between heating and eating?
Good question.
Mr. Speaker, for the record, the Ontario Energy Board announced an increase of 4.6%. We've heard many, many other numbers over there, Mr. Speaker. There are a significant number of people across the province, Mr. Speaker, who are finding pressures.
The member from Renfrew-Nipissing-Pembroke is warned, whether he's in his seat or not.
Never seen is any member of the Progressive Conservative Party, such as the member from Pembroke-Nipissing, Renfrew, actually sending out to their constituents the list of all the mitigation measures that are available in the province of Ontario, Mr. Speaker. Starting with the Ontario Clean Energy Benefit, starting with the Ontario Energy and Property Tax Credit, the Low Income Energy Assistance Program, the Save on Energy Home Assistance Program, and in the north, Mr. Speaker, a very significant tax credit for customers. For those people, Mr. Speaker, who are stretched financially,
answer.
It is a serious problem. The LDCs work with them on a one-on-one basis, Mr. Speaker, across the province of Ontario.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Supplementary, the member from Carleton, Mississippi Mills.
To the Minister of Energy. Minister, Hydro One's smart meter system does not work in rural Ontario, and the system of estimating usage results in chaotic, wrongful hydro bills that are very high, as much as twice as high as neighbours in urban areas that are served by Hydro Ottawa. When the city was created in 2001, one of the conditions was that all residents of the new city would become customers of Hydro Ottawa. Minister, you can finish the job you should have done 14 years ago when you were mayor of Ottawa. There are 43,000 Hydro One customers in rural Ottawa. Minister, will you honour the agreement of 2001 and transfer these 43,000 customers to Hydro Ottawa where they should be?
Thank you.
Mr. Speaker, there's a systemic problem we have that was created by former Premier
Member from Leeds,
Harris,
Granville, second time.
In 1999, Mr. Speaker, when he legislated amalgamation across the province in the cities of Ottawa, Sudbury, Hamilton, and a number of others, Mr. Speaker, he also amalgamated
Member from Bruce Gray Owen Sound, second
when he
time.
Left stranded in the system Hydro One customers that were within other city boundaries. Yes, as mayor, I tried to negotiate a solution.
Member from Nipissing.
All the other mayors across the province had. Mr. Speaker, we are now talking to Hydro Ottawa, but we also also have to talk to Sudbury and Hamilton and all the other cities where Mike Harris created this problem.
New question.
Start the clock. Glad you recognize that. No question. The member from Windsor West.
Thank you, Speaker. My question is to the Premier. Students in Durham, Northern Ontario's Rainbow District, and Peel Region have been without classes for weeks. Over 800,000 elementary students and their families face an uncertain future as educators undertake job action. I'm reminding the Premier of this because it doesn't seem like her government is doing anything to move this process along. No. Speaker, will the Premier finally acknowledge that the utter failure of contract talks falls at the feet of her government and actually work to bring school boards and education workers together rather than driving them apart?
Minister of Education.
Minister of Education.
And it's precisely because we want to bring all the parties together that we actually created the new legislation, because we wanted to have the boards at the table. We wanted to have the union at the table. We wanted to have the government at the table so that all three parties can come together and create a solution. It's precisely because we believe in negotiated solutions that we are still working very, very hard at the table. We have 9 different tables going, and that we're working very, very hard at each of those tables to get collective agreements. And we know it's going to be difficult. We know it's been slow. But we believe that the way to get the issues resolved are at the table. And there's no other way to do this other than negotiating solutions, and we will keep working at that.
Supplementary.
Thank you, Speaker. Again to the Premier. It's this government that implemented the current bargaining legislation. It's this government that cut $250 million in education. Minister, page 230 of your own budget. Maybe you should check your facts. Forced the closure of 88 schools and cut vital special education programs. It's this government's underfunding that put 21 early childhood educator jobs in Windsor and Essex County and 50 educational assistant positions and ECEs in Bruce Gray on the chopping block. Now, this Liberal government is continuing to fail families by dragging their feet in negotiations and blaming everyone else but themselves for the chaos in our school. Speaker, when will this government finally accept responsibility for throwing our schools into chaos and work with education workers? Keyword is with, to get students back to class.
Question. Thank you. Minister.
And I think we need to go back and look at what happened during the development of our collective bargaining legislation. We actually worked with every one of the unions, with all 4 school board associations, and we worked together to draft that legislation. We went around and around and around. We looked at first drafts and made some changes. We looked at second drafts. We looked at some changes that the NDP suggested and incorporated some suggestions that the NDP made in terms of the collective bargaining legislation. Everybody involved worked together to make that collective bargaining legislation a reality.
Yes,
and we've worked together to decide which are central issues, which are local issues. That was negotiated.
Thank
we have minutes of settlement where we've agreed.
Thank you. Your question, the member from Halton.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, my question is to the Minister of Agriculture, Food and Rural Affairs. Minister, Ontario's economic landscape is changing. Economic development and job growth in Ontario's small and rural communities continue to face unique challenges. In my riding of Halton, the Country Heritage Agricultural Society and the Milton Education Village Innovation Centre are 2 local projects that have benefited from the government's support of rural economic growth. They have used the government's support to develop and promote new business opportunities across the region. Throughout the province, there there are programs like these designed to assist rural communities, including the Eastern Ontario Development Fund and the Southwestern Ontario Development Fund. Mr. Speaker, through you to the Minister, could the Minister please update the House on what our government is doing to strengthen rural economies?
Thank you. Minister of Agriculture.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. I want to thank the member from Halton for her question this morning, and I know the great work that she does with the agriculture associations within her riding of Halton.
That's true.
In fact, the RED program, Mr. Speaker, is a program that has transcended various administrations in the province of Ontario. In fact, I believe it was the member from Oxford that actually brought the RED program into being. It is the Rural Economic Development Program. It provides $14.5 billion on an annual basis, helping rural communities and regions grow their economies, attract investment, invest in their skills. Through RED since 2003, we've invested over $180 million in 565 projects, generating over $1.2 billion in economic activity, and indeed, Mr. Speaker, creating and supporting over 36,000 jobs in rural Ontario. Mr. Speaker, we'll continue to work and strengthen rural communities in every part of this province.
Thank you. Supplementary.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, and thank you to the Minister for his answer. It's great to hear that the Ontario government takes the economic needs of small and rural communities seriously, and I know that business owners in my riding will be happy to know that our government is committed to supporting their goals of providing goods, services, and job opportunities for Halton residents. The RED program, as you mentioned, has a strong record of job creation and economic growth and helping rural communities prosper across Ontario. But Minister, I have heard that the RED program is temporarily pausing application intakes to conduct a review. I'm sure many rural communities will be interested in the types of RED projects that it will now focus on. Speaker, could the Minister please elaborate on the kinds of projects the RED program
will
support?
Thank you. Minister.
Excellent. Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. I thank the member from Halton for a supplementary. And you know, Mr. Speaker, in fact, the Agricultural Hall of Fame for Ontario is actually located in her riding of Halton, which is a very great, great facility. To ensure the RED program continues to meet expectations for industry, community organization, municipalities, my ministry is temporarily pausing application intakes to conduct a thorough program review. We know that to be competitive, we must become more innovative and flexible. That's why the RED program will continue to focus on those high-value, low-cost projects and great jobs and build a foundation for economic growth. An example. For example, Mr. Speaker, here's a great one. The Oxford Cattle Company Limited is receiving $500,000 to implement a pilot fueling hub that creates new natural gas blends to sell consumers in rural Ontario.
Excellent idea.
Mr. Speaker, RED projects show off innovation and community partnerships that are emblematic of rural Ontario. I know, Mr. Speaker, by working together, we'll strengthen rural communities right across this great province.
Your question, the member from Chatham-Kent, Essex.
Thank you, Speaker. My question is to the Minister of Energy. Minister, your government's delays on crucial hydro transmission projects are costing Leamington jobs and investment.
Minister Major of Economic Fresh Farms
recently announced that they would be expanding in Ohio. Leamington lost out on 300 jobs and $200 million in investments because of your government's inaction.
You got to get it right.
In 2011, I asked former Finance Minister Dwight Duncan about this issue, and he said, and I quote, "We're now ready to move to construction." Minister, it's 2015, and no plans have ever been confirmed. Given all the broken promises, local officials are outraged because more businesses are saying they're looking elsewhere.
Question.
Minister, Leamington needs to know if you are willing to move this vital power project forward.
Thank you.
Forget the turbines.
Thank you. Minister of Energy.
Mr. Speaker, we've adopted a program of responding specifically to the growers in that particular area. Mr. Speaker, we've created combined heat and powers. We're going through a process.
Stop the clock. I'm going to remind both the member from Prince Edward Hastings and the government, deputy government house leader, that when the mics are on, you're taking advantage, and I'm not going to let you anymore. Carry on.
In fact, Mr. Speaker, we're in the process of doing procurements right now to satisfy that industry in your community. But, Mr. Speaker, we have been rebuilding the system now for the last 10 years because of the mess they made. I want to repeat the quote, Mr. Speaker. This is from the member of Simcoe Gray in 2001 when he was Minister of Energy. This summer, when we didn't have enough electricity in this province and all the air conditioners were running, we had to buy power. I had to pay $7 million one day to keep the air conditioners on in the hospitals. Mr. Speaker, we've invested in a reliable system.
Stop. The Leader of the Opposition will come to order. Thank you. And the member from Chatham-Kent Essex will come to order. Carry on.
Mr. Speaker, we've created a clean and reliable system, Mr. Speaker. So clean, Mr. Speaker, that we've taken the equivalent of 7 million cars off the road.
Thank you. Supplementary, the member from York Central.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. My question is to the Minister of Energy. Minister, it is essential for Ontarians to have access to affordable electricity. Expensive electricity has and will continue to destabilize our province if you don't change direction. The lights go on, the day begins. Hospital rooms operate, businesses make money and provide jobs. No one in Ontario can live without electricity. People depend on it. Minister, your energy policy takes advantage of our dependence on electricity. We are captive consumers. Your policy has destabilized day-to-day life. Billions wasted on smart meters, the Green Energy Act, and clandestine gas plant cover-ups. You just keep handing the ever-increasing bill to ratepayers. Why are you bent on destroying any prospect of affordable electricity that is so essential to the social and economic value of our province?
Mr. Speaker, over the course of the last 10 years, we have spent $34 billion in the system, creating generation, transmission, and building a clean system. Mr. Speaker, we've built the new tunnel in Niagara, Mr. Speaker, a $1.2 billion investment. We've expanded hydro in northern Ontario through the Lower Matagami, Mr. Speaker, a $2.6 billion investment in the system. We have an extremely reliable system, but in the process of rebuilding the system, we built it clean. We got rid of 25% of our generation, which was dirty coal. We are saving $4 billion a year, Mr. Speaker, on environmental and health costs by creating a clean system. Mr. Speaker, we are one of the best, if not the best, in North America. It's the largest emissions reduction program in North America, Mr. Speaker. It's a record we're proud of, and, Mr. Speaker, we're continuing in that direction. Thank you.
Any questions?
Mr. Speaker, my question is of transportation. The Union Pearson Express will run every 15 minutes from 5:30 in the morning to 1 a.m. each night. Heavy, noisy, dirty diesel trains will run past homes, playgrounds, and schools. And yet the government doesn't seem to care about this disruption. Even now, with construction ongoing 24/7, it means children can't sleep at night and people can't live in their homes. What will the government do to address the concerns of residents in all ridings up and down the tracks?
Thank you. Stop the clock. Members will come to order. Question's been put.
Thanks very much, Speaker, and I want to thank the member from Parkdale High Park not only for the question today, but also for the correspondence that she has sent to me earlier this month. And I also want to acknowledge the work of my colleagues, the member from York Southwestern and the member from Davenport, who have communicated with me and my ministry on a regular basis, and the team at Metrolinx regarding the Union Pearson Express. Speaker, I believe the member is aware of the fact that back in 2012, there was considerable work undertaken by way of a study to determine what kind of noise mitigation was required along this corridor. As a result of the work that was undertaken in that assessment, Speaker, there are a number of noise walls that are being built that are under construction that I understand those identified as being required in that initial study are going to be completed by the time that the Union Pearson Express comes into service, which, Speaker, of course, is June the 6th. So work is being undertaken. I know the team at Metrolinx has folks on the ground trying their best to work closely with the members, but also with the community itself. Thanks very much, Speaker.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. The government in this instance is so desperate to get this project done in time for the Games that construction crews right now are keeping residents awake all night, 24 hours a day, with jackhammers and heavy equipment. The intense construction is even damaging the foundations of neighbouring homes. Mr. Speaker, residents want a clear answer, and they need one now. What will the government do now to compensate them for construction, damage, and disruption?
Minister.
Thanks, Speaker. And again, I thank the member for the question. I didn't point out in my initial answer that, in fact, Metrolinx has done extensive consultation, working closely with the communities affected by the construction of the Union Pearson Express. So, for example, Speaker, Metrolinx publicly recruited members for 8 committees, and over 150 community members signed up to participate. And Metrolinx also conducted 24 committee meetings with the community over the course of that time. I mentioned the noise mitigation measures that are currently under construction that will continue to be constructed. Metrolinx also has a property damage claims process to deal with any damage that might arise from this work. But, Speaker, I should point out the Union Pearson Express is a clear example of the wonderful outcome that we can achieve when we work together to build infrastructure, comes into service on June the 6th, on time, on budget, for the first time ever, Speaker, a dedicated air rail link between Union Station and Pearson Airport. Thanks very much.
Be seated, please. Be seated, please. New question, the member from Beaches, East New York.
Well, thank you, Speaker, and my question, and what a great segue into my question to the Minister of Economic Development, Employment and Infrastructure, who is doing a great job in helping building Ontario up. Now, Mr. Speaker, to quote the Canadian Federation of Independent Business, since the global recession, we've seen a rebirth in manufacturing in Ontario. Last month alone, Ontario's manufacturing sector gained 1,200 new positions, and almost 800 positions the month before. Now, our government understands that more work is needed to keep this sector on a positive path forward, and our budget outlines some of that work. Well, last night I held a town hall meeting in my riding of Beaches, East York, and was asked about the great programs and initiatives in this year's budget to help our province's manufacturing sector continue to grow.
Speaker.
Would the minister please inform this House about how this year's budget is helping Ontario's manufacturing sector?
Minister of Economic Development, Employment and Infrastructure.
Well, thank you, Mr. Speaker. And I must say the member is doing his share in Beaches, East York as well in building up Ontario and building up his community. I'm delighted, Mr. Speaker, to respond to that, because this budget does so much for our economy and so much for our manufacturing sector. If you go back to 2007, the number one ask of our business community through the Jobs and Prosperity Council was to increase the accelerated deduction for investments for manufacturing and processing machinery. We were pleased to do it back then, Mr. Speaker, but this deduction was due to expire in 2015-16. I'm very pleased, Mr. Speaker, that our finance minister saw the wisdom through this budget, if passed, that will extend this important deduction for another 10 years. Why is that important, Mr. Speaker? It's an incentive for manufacturers to keep investing in upgrading their machinery, investing in upgrading their plants, and creating jobs across this province.
Well, thank you, Speaker. And I would really like to thank the minister for that update, and especially for continuing the deduction for accelerated depreciation. Now, Speaker, it's important to note that our corporate income tax rate in Ontario is almost 13 percentage points lower than the average rate in the United States between federal and provincial taxes, and that this is partially responsible for Ontario being a top jurisdiction for direct foreign investments. Now, this extended deduction will make Ontario even more competitive as a manufacturing jurisdiction for our manufacturers from around the world. Speaker, this deduction is not the only program that is helping our province's manufacturing sector continue to grow. So would the minister please inform the House on these other programs that are included in this year's budget that will help foster growth in this key Ontario sector and help create jobs to support all Ontarians and support our tax revenue?
Thank you. Yeah.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
And I thank the NDP for their continued heckles all along the way. It's got me smiling. Mr. Speaker, we've taken a number of provisions in this budget beyond what I just talked about. For instance, we're increasing the Jobs and Prosperity Fund by $200 million to $2.7 billion. That's going to help us expand that into the forestry sector, which is important to a number of our northern members. It's also going to help us continue to secure those important manufacturing mandates, like Honda's expansion in Alliston, Mr. Speaker, an $857 billion investment in this province. We're also continuing in this budget, Mr. Speaker, the Southwestern Ontario and the Eastern Ontario Development Funds. Let me talk a little bit about their impact. We've invested $120 million as a government, Mr. Speaker. It's leveraged $1.3 billion of private sector investment, creating 31,000 jobs. Mr. Speaker, this budget will continue to create jobs and build our economy and build on.
Thank you. New question, the member from Parry Sound, Muskoka.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. I have a question to the Premier. Premier, constituents from Parry Sound, Muskoka boarded a bus to Queen's Park this morning to send you a message. Your government needs to get hydro rates under control. It's reached the point that people are afraid to open their hydro bill each month. Among the hundreds of hydro complaints I've received, Dana from Trout Creek wrote me, quote, huge bills from Hydro One are going to cause us to go bankrupt, close quote, adding that her family's income is only slightly higher than what qualifies for any form of government assistance. Instead of providing assurance on hydro rates for Ontario families this month, you raised the on-peak hydro rates 15% to 16.1 cents per kilowatt hour. Premier, why is your government turning a deaf ear to people like Dana and making no attempt to keep hydro rates from climbing even higher?
Well, Mr. Speaker, the Minister of Energy has said repeatedly this morning in response to questions on this issue that we're very acutely aware of the situation where people are struggling, where they need support, Mr. Speaker. That's why the programs that we have put in place are targeted at those people, Mr. Speaker. The fact is that we inherited an energy system that was degraded, Mr. Speaker, that needed to be built up. We've done that, Mr. Speaker, and there is a cost associated with that. We acknowledge that. But, Mr. Speaker, I hope that the member opposite, in his office, when people come in to talk to him about their energy rates, I hope he points them to the programs that they might qualify for, Mr. Speaker, because he knows full well that there are programs that are targeted specifically at people who are struggling with their energy bills, Mr. Speaker.
Thank you. Supplementary, the member from Stormont-Dundas and South Glengarry.
Thank you, Speaker. To the Premier. Premier, in Stormont-Dundas and South Glengarry, Hydro's mismanagement of its billing practices, as well as your unaffordable green energy charges, are a source of pain and financial ruin. The local conservation authority received an unjustifiable $50,000 bill after it had already been removed from its bank account and has been fighting Hydro with no avail. The Maple Ridge Centre has advised that an old meter had been disconnected, when in reality it hadn't, and after 2 years of paying $12,000 a year, received an additional $25,000 bill that Hydro is refusing to drop. Across Ontario, individuals, businesses, agencies and charities are having to shoulder the economic cost of your mismanagement on your energy file. How do you justify bringing electricity poverty to the province, which should be instead be the economic engine of Canada?
Speaker, let me just again, there have been many questions along this line asked this morning. The Minister of Energy has been very clear about the fact that we had to make investments. There was a degraded energy system. There's a cost associated with those, Mr. Speaker, and that we have worked very hard to put programs in place and, Mr. Speaker, to make decisions that actually would take costs out of the system, renegotiating contracts and putting downward pressure on rates. But, Mr. Speaker, underlying this question is a question about the nature of Hydro One and whether that is a company that could be run better, Mr. Speaker. So I expect that the member opposite agrees with us that it is a company that could be run better, Mr. Speaker, that we should do everything in our power to make sure it is run well, Mr. Speaker, and that is exactly part of the initiative that we are undertaking as a result of the recommendations from Ed Clark and his panel. It needs to be a better run company, Mr. Speaker, for the people of this province.
I beg to inform the House that I have today laid upon the table the 2013-14 annual report of the Chief Electoral Officer.
We have a deferred vote on the amendment to the amendment to the motion of our allocation of time on Bill 91, an act to implement budget measures and to enact and amend various acts. Call in the members. This will be a 5-minute bell.
Would all members please take their seats? All members, please take your seats. Please.
On May 11th, Mr. Nackley moved government notice of motion number 21. Mr. Clark then moved an amendment to Mr. Nackley's motion. Mr. Bradley then moved an amendment to Mr. Clark's amendment. We will first deal with Mr. Bradley's amendment to the amendment, which is as follows. That the amendment to the motion be amended as follows. Dispense. Dispense. All those in favour of Mr. Bradley's amendment to the amendment, please rise one at a time and be recognized by the clerk.
Mr. Nackley.
Mr. Nackley.
Mr. Bradley.
Mr. Bradley.
Mr. Shirelli.
Mr. Shirelli.
Madame Mayer.
Madame Mayer.
Mr. Souza.
Mr. Souza.
Ms. Wynn.
Ms. Wynn.
Ms. Matthews.
Ms. Matthews.
Mr. Hoskins.
Mr. Hoskins.
Ms. Sandals.
Ms. Sandals.
Mr. Duguid.
Mr. Duguid.
Ms. McCharles.
Ms. McCharles.
Mr. Quinter.
Mr. Quinter.
Mr. Cole.
Mr. Cole.
Mr. Takar.
Mr. Takar.
Mr. Barardinetti.
Mr. Barardinetti.
Mr. Dillon.
Mr. Dillon.
Mr. Quadri.
Mr. Quadri.
Mr. Orzetti.
Mr. Orzetti.
Mr. Gravel.
Mr. Gravel.
Mr. McMeekin.
Mr. McMeekin.
Mr. Murray.
Mr. Murray.
Mr. Chan.
Mr. Chan.
Mr. Coteau.
Mr. Coteau.
Mr. Leal.
Mr. Leal.
Mr. Flynn.
Mr. Flynn.
Mr. Zimmer.
Mr. Zimmer.
Mr. Delaney.
Mr. Delaney.
Mr. Balkison.
Mr. Balkison.
Ms.
Albanese.
Mr. Dixon.
Mr. Dixon.
Ms. Manga.
Ms. Manga.
Mr. Pratt.
Mr. Pratt.
Ms. Wong.
Ms. Wong.
Ms. Hunter.
Ms. Hunter.
Mr. Sergio.
Mr. Sergio.
Mr. Morrow.
Mr. Morrow.
Ms. Jassy.
Ms. Jassy.
Mr. Del Duca.
Mr. Del Duca.
Ms. Domerla.
Ms. Domerla.
Mr. Fraser.
Mr. Fraser.
Mr. Anderson.
Mr. Anderson.
Mr. Baker.
Mr. Baker.
Mr. Ballard.
Mr. Ballard.
Mr. Dong.
Mr. Dong.
Ms. Hogarth.
Ms. Hogarth.
Ms. Koala.
Ms. Koala.
Madame Lalonde.
Madame Lalonde.
Ms. Molly.
Ms. Molly.
Mrs. Martin.
Mrs. Martin.
Mrs. McGarry.
Mrs. McGarry.
Ms. McMahon.
Ms. McMahon.
Mr. Milchin.
Mr. Milchin.
Ms. Naidu Harris.
Ms. Naidu Harris.
Mr. Potts.
Mr. Potts.
Mr. Rinaldi.
Mr. Rinaldi.
Ms. Verniel.
Ms. Verniel.
All those opposed, please rise one at a time. Be recognized by the clerk.
Mr. Clark.
Mr. Clark.
Mr. Arna.
Mr. Arna.
Mr. Hudak.
Mr. Hudak.
Mr. Hardiman.
Mr. Hardiman.
Ms. McLeod.
Ms. McLeod.
Mr. Wilson.
Mr. Wilson.
Mr. Fidelli.
Mr. Fidelli.
Mr. Yakubuski.
Mr. Yakubuski.
Mr. Miller Perry Sound Muskoka.
Mr. Miller Perry Sound Muskoka.
Mr. Dunlop.
Mr. Dunlop.
Ms. Jones.
Ms. Jones.
Ms. Thompson.
Thompson.
Mrs. Monroe.
Ms. Monroe.
Ms. Scott.
Ms. Scott.
Mr. Urich.
Mr. Urich.
Mr. Bailey.
Mr. Bailey.
Mr. Hillier.
Mr. Hillier.
Mr. Walker.
Mr. Walker.
Mr. Smith.
Mr. Smith.
Mr. Harris.
Mr. Harris.
Mr. Nichols.
Mr. Nichols.
Ms. Marteau.
Ms. Marteau.
Mr. McDonnell.
Mr. McDonnell.
Mr. McLaren.
Mr. McLaren.
Mr. Pettipies.
Mr. Pettipies.
Mr. Bisson.
Mr. Bisson.
Mr. Singh.
Mr. Singh.
Ms. Horvath.
Ms. Horvath.
Mr. Vantaugh.
Mr. Vantaugh.
Ms. DeNovo.
Ms. DeNovo.
Mr. Tavins.
Mr. Tavins.
Mr. Miller Hamilton East Stoney Creek.
Mr. Miller Hamilton East Stoney Creek.
Ms. Sattler.
Ms. Sattler.
Ms. Taylor.
Ms. Taylor.
Mr. Natashek.
Mr. Natashek.
Ms. Armstrong.
Ms. Armstrong.
Madame Jelena.
Madame Jelena.
Ms. Fife.
Ms. Fife.
Ms. Forrester.
Ms. Forrester.
Mr. Mantha.
Mr. Mantha.
Mr. Hatfield.
Mr. Hatfield.
Ms. Gretzky.
Ms. Gretzky.
Mr. Gates.
Mr. Gates.
Ms. French.
Ms. French.
The ayes are 56, the nays are 44.
The ayes being 56 and the nays being 44, I declare the amendment to the amendment carried. We will now deal with Mr. Clark's amendment to the motion as amended, which is as follows, that the motion be amended by deleting everything following the bill shall dispense. Dispense. Is it the pleasure of the House that the amendment as amendment carried? No. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
All those opposed say nay.
Nay.
In my opinions, the ayes have it. The motion is carried. On division. We will now deal with Mr. Nackfee's motion. As amended, which is as follows, that pursuant to the Standing Order 47, dispense, dispense. Too late.
It is the pleasure of the House. The motion carry as amended. I heard a no. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
All those opposed say nay.
Nay.
In my opinions, the ayes have it. On division. Carry. On division. The motion is carried as amended. We have a deferred vote on the motion of second reading of Bill 6, an act to enact the Infrastructure for Jobs and Prosperity Act 2014. Calling the members, this will be a 5-minute bell. On December 9, 2014, Mr. Nackvie moved second reading of Bill 6. All those in favor, please rise one at a time. Be recognized by the clerk.
Mr. Duguid.
Mr. Duguid.
Mr. Nackvie.
Mr. Nackvie.
Mr. Bradley.
Mr. Bradley.
Mr. Shirelli.
Mr. Shirelli.
Madame Mayer.
Madame Mayer.
Mr. Souza.
Mr. Souza.
Ms. Wynn.
Ms. Wynn.
Ms. Matthews.
Ms. Matthews.
Mr. Hoskins.
Mr. Hoskins.
Ms. Sandals.
Ms. Sandals.
Ms. McCharles.
Ms. McCharles.
Mr. Quinter.
Mr. Quinter.
Mr. Cole.
Mr. Cole.
Mr. Takar.
Mr. Takar.
Mr. Bardinetti.
Mr. Bardinetti.
Mr. Dillon.
Mr. Dillon.
Mr. Quadri.
Mr. Quadri.
Mr. Orzetti.
Mr. Orzetti.
Mr. Gravel.
Mr. Gravel.
Mr. McMeekin.
Mr. McMeekin.
Mr. Murray.
Mr. Murray.
Mr. Chan.
Mr. Chan.
Mr. Coteau.
Mr. Coteau.
Mr. Leal.
Mr. Leal.
Mr. Flynn.
Mr. Flynn.
Mr. Zimmer.
Mr. Zimmer.
Mr. Delaney.
Mr. Delaney.
Mr. Balkison.
Mr. Balkison.
Ms. Albanese.
Ms. Albanese.
Mr. Dixon.
Mr. Dixon.
Ms. Manga.
Ms. Manga.
Mr. Kraft.
Mr. Kraft.
Ms. Wong.
Ms. Wong.
Ms. Hunter.
Ms. Hunter.
Mr. Sergio.
Mr. Sergio.
Mr. Morrow.
Mr. Morrow.
Ms. Jassy.
Ms. Jassy.
Mr. Del Duca.
Mr. Del Duca.
Ms. Domerla.
Ms. Domerla.
Mr. Fraser.
Mr. Fraser.
Mr. Anderson.
Mr. Anderson.
Mr. Baker.
Mr. Baker.
Mr. Ballard.
Mr. Ballard.
Mr. Dong.
Mr. Dong.
Ms. Hogarth.
Ms. Hogarth.
Ms. Koala.
Ms. Koala.
Madame Lalonde.
Madame Lalonde.
Ms. Molly.
Ms. Molly.
Mrs. Martin.
Mrs. Martin.
Mrs. McGarry.
Mrs. McGarry.
Ms. McMahon.
Ms. McMahon.
Mr. Milchin.
Mr. Milchin.
Ms. Naidu Harris.
Ms. Naidu Harris.
Mr. Potts.
Mr. Potts.
Mr. Rinaldi.
Mr. Rinaldi.
Ms. Verniel.
Ms. Verniel.
Mr. Arnott.
Mr. Arnott.
Mr. Hudak.
Mr. Hudak.
Mr. Hardiman.
Mr. Hardiman.
Ms. McLeod.
Ms. McLeod.
Mr. Wilson.
Mr. Wilson.
Mr. Fidelli.
Mr. Fidelli.
Mr. Yakubuski.
Mr. Yakubuski.
Mr. Clark.
Mr. Clark.
Mr. Miller Perry Sound Muskoka.
Mr. Miller Perry Sound Muskoka.
Mr. Dunlop.
Mr. Dunlop.
Ms. Jones.
Ms. Jones.
Ms. Thompson.
Ms. Thompson.
Mrs. Monroe.
Mrs. Monroe.
Ms. Scott.
Ms. Scott.
Mr. Urich.
Mr. Urich.
Mr. Bailey.
Mr. Bailey.
Mr. Hilliard.
Mr. Hilliard.
Mr. Walker.
Mr. Walker.
Mr. Smith.
Mr. Smith.
Mr. Harris.
Mr. Harris.
Mr. Nichols.
Mr. Nichols.
Ms. Marteau.
Ms. Marteau.
Mr. McDonnell.
Mr. McDonnell.
Mr. McLaren.
Mr. McLaren.
Mr. Pettipiece.
Mr. Pettipiece.
Mr. Nadeshaw.
Mr. Nadeshaw.
Mr. Singh.
Mr. Singh.
Ms. Horvath.
Ms. Horvath.
Mr. Bisson.
Mr. Bisson.
Mr. Vantal.
Mr. Vantal.
Ms. DeNovo.
Ms. DeNovo.
Mr. Tabbins.
Mr. Tabbins.
Ms. Sattler.
Ms. Sattler.
Ms. Taylor.
Ms. Taylor.
Ms. Armstrong.
Ms. Armstrong.
Madame Gélinas.
Madame Gélinas.
Ms. Fife.
Ms. Fife.
Ms. Forrester.
Ms. Forrester.
Mr. Mantha.
Mr. Mantha.
Mr. Hatfield.
Mr. Hatfield.
Ms. Gretzky.
Ms. Gretzky.
Mr. Gates.
Mr. Gates.
Ms. French.
Ms. French.
All those opposed, please rise one at a time. Be recognized by the clerk.
Zero.
The ayes being 99 and the nays being zero, I declare the motion carried. Pursuant to the order of the House dated May 12th, the bill is ordered referred to the Standing Committee on General Government. The member from Leeds Grenville on a point of order.
Speaker, I just want to invite all members to room 351 for a reception honoring the Maoritown Glassworks display at Queen's Park. I have a number of constituents here. They're very proud of this display on the first floor. Excellent. So I hope you'll see it, And if you're available, please come to room 351 between 2 and 3 this afternoon. Thank you, Speaker.
Thank you. The member from Essex.
Adrian and Andrew LaCoit and their father, David LaCoit, are here today from the United Kingdom, here to watch the legislative proceedings. I want to welcome them here.
Thank you, Attorney General.
Monsieur le Président, it gives me a great pleasure to introduce two of my distinguished constituents, Catherine and Michael Duncan.
The member from Nickel Belt.
I had some visitors, Lauren Leblanc and Jenny Gasry. They were here for the Alzheimer's Society. I wanted to welcome them.
There are no further deferred votes. This House stands recessed until 3 p.m. this afternoon.